6 years ago, June 9th, 2004, my body had quite a trauma because scar tissue from a surgery 7 years before wrapped around my colon and choked it off. It became infected, turned gangrene, and then it burst, my colon, inside me while I'm outside trying to get my garden planted. And I know that took place over a period of a couple of weeks, but I had had a lot of health issues prior to that, cancer and stuff, and I was really good at being able to handle pain. So with the time period that the doctors say that the infection was getting stronger and redder and getting ready to burst and turning gangrene, I was teaching second grade and I was having a great time and teaching third grade. But when it burst, I went into septic shock, which is when you smack a spider, its arms and legs curl up just like this. And that is called septic shock. It's called posturing in septic shock. And that is so that God did that so that he would preserve our head and our trunk. And I did that, and I stayed that way until the fireman came and gave me oxygen. And then my arms and legs came back out. But my autonomic nervous system didn't. My autonomic nervous system really suffered. I had surgery that night, and they removed somewhere between 2 and 3 feet of my large colon. They weren't sure that I was going to survive, but I did, which people say that just set me up for a miracle. But then I was healing, and I still was fainting constantly. I was fainting in my classroom trying to teach. And the doctors examined me and said, your autonomic nervous system has in part fried. And the autonomic nervous system is a nervous system that controls your heartbeat, your blood pressure, your temperature, your digestion, even your very breath. It's all the things that God did to our bodies and does through us that we never have to think about. They're automatic. So my autonomic nervous system required taking lots and lots of pills. I took a pill in the morning to keep my heartbeat from going too high, and I took a pill in the morning to keep my heartbeat from going too low, because it did both very often. And the same thing for my blood pressure, my temperature, my breathing, for pumping the blood, for my digestion. Because the 2 to 3 feet of my colon had been removed, I had 10 to 15 bouts of diarrhea a day. I spent probably 2 hours in the bathroom. One of the major things that got us to Costco is we could buy toilet paper in those huge, big boxes. Something nobody likes to think about, but oh my gosh, you are so blessed if you can go to the bathroom normally. It's something I don't take for granted now. So I was taking somewhere between 45 to 55 pills a day, because the extra 10 would be pain medicines that I would take just because the pain was excruciating. My heart, it pumped, but it did. The circulation didn't go all the way down to my feet. So my legs, if I kept them still, they would turn purple or blue. When I woke up in the morning, my arms and my legs were blue and purple and really hurt. Blood that's not moving hurts because God created us for our blood to circulate. During my days, I could no longer teach because I was fainting once or twice until I got the message and kind of laid down for the rest of the day. I had to be very careful about what I ate because anything would set off the explosive diarrhea, and didn't want to go there. So my activities were very much curtailed. The doctors told me that my disease was progressive and terminal. So as the years went by, it kept hitting different organs, and the organ would begin to show deterioration. The communication system between your brain, your heart, didn't feed that organ what it needed, and it would wither and die. And so I would have surgery, take out that organ. And as that was happening, I was going to every church, every minister I could find, because I just knew from seeing those TV shows that if I could walk up to someone and they would say, "You are healed in the name of Jesus," I'd be healed. I was teaching a Bible study through Young Life, and I taught my girls each week a story in the New Testament, and Jesus healed them all. And we'd go to another one, and we'd be reading, and Jesus healed them all. And I kept saying, "Girls, I'm one of them all. I know my doctors are saying this is terminal, but I know by Hebrews 13:8 that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And because he's the same today as he was yesterday, he wants to heal me. He's the same forever." So I traveled to Pennsylvania. I traveled to New York. I traveled to Charlotte, to Atlanta. I went everywhere because I was pressing heaven because I knew Jesus wanted to heal me. I wrote down on slips of paper, put them in all my shoes, Psalm 118:17, "I will not die but live and proclaim what the Lord has done." I did that because as a second grade teacher, in my little second grade mind, I thought that if I wrote it down, I would be standing on the word of God. And I also, I said it just about every time I got a thought, I would just repeat, "I will not die but live and proclaim what the Lord has done." That was my healing scripture. Now, one of the surgeries required that I be in the hospital, and that the night after surgery, the nurses are constantly coming in and saying, "We need to check and make sure your sleeping pill's working," or "We need to give you a sleeping pill," or "We need to draw blood." Just constant motion. And I had a little notebook by my bed, and on that notebook, I would write things like, "Need deodorant." That night, I wrote, "Need deodorant, Randy Clark. Need a softer pillow, Randy Clark." By the next morning, I had written down Randy Clark's name 5 times. Didn't know who he was, so I started asking the doctors, the nurses, my husband, "Who's Randy Clark?" They didn't know. "Who's Randy Clark?" They didn't know. So I asked my friend, Mary Haas, and she said, "Susan, Randy is the head of a worldwide healing ministry. Go home and Google him." So as soon as I got home, I grabbed that computer and I read about Randy Clark, saw that he lived in Pennsylvania, called and tried to make an appointment with him. Wasn't able to make an appointment with him, but I made an appointment with Sue and Ed downstairs. And I had a wonderful time. My husband and I drove up. They did rebuilding the foundations with us. It was wonderful. But the whole time, I kept thinking, "Can I run down the hall and see Randy Clark?" And Sue said, "He's not even here. He's actually at Voice of the Apostles out of state." We drove back home, and she had told me to look on his website that he had his travel tour. His itinerary was on the website. I looked at that itinerary, saw that he was coming to High Point, North Carolina, 30 minutes away from my home. So all I needed to do, this was October, was make it to April. And this is when I was not doing well. I needed help walking in and out. I had a wheelchair and a walker that I used when I left my house. I used my walker in my house because I frequently would pass out in the kitchen. And it's just really hard. Whenever I stopped, I would pass out. So I used my walker then. So as we got closer to Christmas last year, the doctor said, "Frank, you need to bring your kids home for Christmas." The end of the winter, my mom and my sisters helped me go through my sweaters and we gave my sweaters and my coats away. And I figured it'll be okay because someone else will be able to use them. And if I get healed, I can go out and get new ones. And I'll know every time I put it on, ha ha, I've been healed. So got to April and I was really not doing well. My family came in, they made the painful decision to bring in hospice. The doctors had suggested it a couple of times before, but I have a very loving and caring family and they wanted to take care of me themselves, but it was getting to be too much. I couldn't do anything much on my own. My daughter was cooking all our meals. My husband was changing my IV lines. I had a PICC line in my arm for somewhere between three and four years that gave me IVs every other day. So April came and I'm living for the end of April when I can go to High Point, when I can stand in front of Randy Clark and he can say, "You are healed in the name of Jesus." I had that in my mind. I am praying and I am pressing. And I got to the very first day of the conference. I walked down that long aisle to the front because if anyone sat in front of me, I would pass out. I'd get dizzy, throw up, pass out. I had Zofran in my pocket. Zofran is God's gift to the planet for those who have nausea. I had it in my pocket. I'm chewing Zofran, and the little old ladies are behind me, sitting on the second row with their hearing aids, and they're poking me and going, "Honey, you don't look very good." And I was thinking, "Hello? No, I don't feel very good. I feel even worse than I look." And it was all I could do to be there. And I felt so good being there, but I couldn't make it. And I left after an hour and a half. I drove back home and I slept all the rest of that day, all through the night, had set my alarm, got up the next morning, determined I'm going to do this again, got up my 2 hours early, had all that diarrhea, had all my medicines, worked on getting my arms and legs moving and getting myself dressed. And I got in my car and I headed back to High Point. Halfway there, explosive diarrhea. Really? Had to turn around, drive back home, take another shower. I laid down on my bed in the towel for a while. Then I went over to the car, cleaned it up as best I could, threw towels all over everywhere, got in the car, and drove back to High Point. I got there late, but I walked down the aisle, that long aisle, sat in my seat, and after about 5-10 minutes, my friend David Miller came over to me and said, "Susan, he will pray for you." Oh my gosh. I was so excited. I jumped up and I said, "Who? Randy?" And David twirled and started heading back up that long aisle and he said, "No, Rodney." "Rodney? Rodney who?" Rodney Hoag is a minister from California. He sat with 7 of my friends in folding metal chairs. We didn't hold hands, but when we sat down, he said, "What is it you would like for me to do?" Now I had this one down. "I want you to say you are healed in the name of Jesus." And he started laughing. He's got a great big old barrel laugh. He started laughing. He said, "Well, I think we can work with that." And he said, "What? Tell me what's wrong." And all my friends just buckshotted all the different symptoms and all the different ailments. He was clearly overwhelmed and he said, "Let's pray." And he began to pray. And as he prayed, he called out every one of my body parts. Just, he started it from my head. But he didn't just say, "Your head, your trunk." He said, "I speak to Susan's head and I ask the power of God to heal Susan, his energy flow through her brain, through her eyes, through her ears, through her nose, through her mouth, through her throat, through her esophagus." He knew his biology far better than me, and he called out every symptom. every body part, and as he did it, I could feel what felt like gold hot chocolate running through me. And the first thing he called out on my right hand side was my right lung. And my head got swimmy, and when he called my heart and called my left lung, when he called my right lung, I could feel this liquid gold come to my right side, and oh my gosh, I knew something was happening. I opened my eyes and I was like, guys, I feel something. This is so cool. No longer did my head hurt. And as he called out my colon, I had seen pictures of what my colon looked like in its new form with the 2 to 3 feet taken out. But as he called my colon, I could feel it going up and over and down. It was the coolest thing. When he got to my legs, my feet, I always squunched my toes. I had on flip-flops. I squunched my toes to keep my body, my blood pumping. I could no longer squunch my toes. I had no control. I felt so good, so warm, and that warm gold hot chocolate just was everywhere. I felt like I was floating. And the first thing I felt, no pain. No pain. My friends grabbed me, kind of helped me up to the front of the church, and laid me down on a mat that one of them had brought. If there is any way that I could have gotten myself up, I am not someone who's going to go lie down on a mat in the front of a church. But I had no control over myself. And I had no pain. So I was thrilled. I laid there, and as I was there on that mat, I distinctly heard, "Go to Brazil." I lifted my head. I looked around. They're all smiling at me, my friends on the front row. I put my head back down. Go to Brazil. By now, I'm thinking, okay, I'm going to go to Brazil. I got up from the mat, and the first thing we did was go to lunch. There was a luncheon in the same side room where I was prayed for. And it was a buffet. As we walked in, I looked at the buffet and thought, precious God, you have given me a test to show me that I am truly healed, because it was a buffet of all the foods I could not eat. No alternatives. It was beef stew, no beef, no flour in the gravy, chopped salad. Now, hello, chopped salad, my family ran at the thought of me eating any salad. That would be explosive diarrhea before I even left the room. White rolls, there again, white flour, and chocolate brownies. I piled my plate up. I was so excited. I just piled it up. I sat down. I ate it all. No poop. It was like, yes, I have been healed. This is so cool. I felt amazing. I drove to the airport to pick up my husband, who had just flown in that night from Wisconsin. And I hadn't called him or texted him. No communication. As soon as he saw me, he started jumping up and down with me and said, Susan, I see it in your eyes. You've been healed. You got your miracle. He knew I wanted it. He knew it's what our whole entire family had been praying for. And he knew as soon as he saw my eyes. My children, not so much. It's hard to hear. Even when you've been praying for a miracle, we don't live in the age that people expect it. We don't live in the culture that people expect it. So my daughter, when I went upstairs to talk to her after bringing him home from the airport, she's laying on her bed. I took one of her earphones out and said, sweetheart, how are you? How's your day? And I was just standing, because remember, if I stood still, I passed out. And Paige knew that, and Paige said, Mom, rock. I said, don't need to. And I asked her another question about school. She said, Mommy, rock. I said, don't need to. And with that, she looked at me, and as soon as she saw my face, she started crying, and she realized that I'd been healed. My sons, they do now, but it took, one son was away at college, and my other two have graduated from Duke and married and live with their families in Philly and in New York. And so when the one from New York came back down to his home in Raleigh, he came over to see me, and as soon as he saw me, he knew. And you would think that would be the end of the story. I got my fairy tale. But the wildest ride of my life began that day. The next morning, I went into the same church for the next day of the healing conference, and my friends ran up to Randy and said, "Randy Clark, Susan was healed yesterday in your service." And he got me up on stage. Now remember, the week before I was bedbound, and I was up in front of all these people giving them my testimony, and I could do it without having to sit down. I could do it. And then after I gave my testimony, I went over and I sat down. At the first break, I'm putting all my books underneath my chair, and I lift up my head, and there are four women in front of me in line. And I'm like, "Hello, Susan Starr here. How can I help you?" And they said, we would like for you to pray for us." And I'm like, "Me? Pray for you? I don't have anything. Guys, I was you yesterday." And they were like, "We would like for you to pray for us." And Rodney came over, and he could see me. I always talk with my hands. So he came over and he said, "Susan, it's a spiritual principle that what you have freely been given, you may freely give away." Oh, now I get it. So I prayed for the women, and as I began to pray, they would fall over. They looked peaceful, but I didn't know that I'd knocked them over, and they were out. What is up with that? And I would pray for the next, they'd fall over. I prayed for all four, boom, 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 boom. Kind of got the last one kind of leaning against my chair. I ran to the bathroom, ran in. Another lady in the bathroom asked me to pray for her. I prayed for her, and she slumped against the mirror and went down. Oh my gosh. I ran into the handicap stall, which ran in there, put my head down, and I cried. I just sobbed because I was freaking out. I had no idea what was going on, and what's up with these hands? Ever since the day I was healed, my hands will go on fire. I have no control over it. I get this gold stuff that is really kind of cool, but my daughter thinks makes me look like a vampire from Sparkles from Twilight. But I get this gold stuff, but the coolest thing is, and the sparkles come and go, the fire comes when God wants to heal someone. I have no control over that. I'll walk into Target. It can be a lady with a burqa over her face, and my hand will go on fire, and it does not stop. It just burns until I pray for whoever it is. I ask God, who do you want me to pray for? And he always chose me. And then it took going and visiting Rodney Hogue to gather up the guts to start praying in public. Because, hello, it's hard enough. This is so new. But I would, in a little sandwich shop, my son went into the bathroom. And while he was in the bathroom, my hand goes on fire. And I'm thinking, really? Now? Okay. The sandwich shop, it was really early, and I went over to the counter. The only people in there are the workers of the sandwich shop. So I go over to the counter and say, "Hi, I believe in healing prayer. May I pray for you?" And I ask if either one of them would like prayer. And this one lady behind the counter at the cash register pulls up her leg, flops it on the counter, and it's in a big old immobilizer. Taylor's still locked in the bathroom, so I'm thinking, well, Taylor's still in the bathroom. At that point, I didn't know that he was locked in the bathroom, but he was still in the bathroom, and I'm out there praying for the woman behind the cash register. I'm praying for her, and I put my hand down, and I can feel what feels like a a faucet or a fire hose. It goes out. And I hold my hand, I pray until I feel a release. So I prayed for her, I prayed on her knee. And when I felt a release, I stopped. And I was getting ready to do the five-step prayer model, the interview. I didn't get a chance. She ripped that immobilizer off and started hopping around. And about then, my son Taylor comes bursting through the bathroom door and going, "Mom, I got locked in the bathroom. I couldn't get out. I don't know what happened." I did. I believe that God locked him in that bathroom so that I would get up the guts to finally pray for someone in public. If you are sick, if you have pain, if you've been injured internally and you need inner healing or outer healing, I would begin by praying and asking God. And God spoke the world into existence. There is power in the spoken word. We've robbed people by having them pray silently. Silent prayer is wonderful. But if you have an infirmity, you need to speak it out. Speak to your body. My hand must line up with the word of God. You need and claim it. Claim John 10:10. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I, Jesus, have come to bring you life and bring it abundant life. You've got to fight for it. You've got to thank God every day for your healing. Even if it's just a little bit, you thank God for that healing, it makes the enemy quake in his boots and run. And if you have symptoms, you call them out as lying symptoms. That's all they are. God, the God of the universe, has healed you. These are lying symptoms. Call it out and tell them they must leave. And then start pressing heaven. And not speak to your body one day, speak to your body every day. And when you feel one teeny bit of improvement, and you will, then start thanking God for that. God loves a thankful heart. There's so much power in gratitude.